You want to be sure your seat of understanding is ready right now, okay? All right. I want you to join with me in a little chorus that we sang like growing up. If you ever went to a church or kids camp or anything, it goes like this. Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so. Little ones to him belong, they are rich and he is strong. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. The Bible tells me so. Turn it around to somebody and say, you know, Jesus loves you. He loves me and he loves all of us here. Hallelujah. Give somebody a hug. Tell them, listen, COVID's an enemy, and we will not be attacked by COVID. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And you may be seated when you can, all right? Hallelujah. Well, I'm telling you, I'm so thankful for Daniel and Johana and Mama Cynthia. I guess that's how we got to call her. I'm not certain I get to cut that right, but anyway. They served you appetizers, but we're getting ready to have the real meal. All right? But that, how many of you know sometimes appetizers are the best thing? Huh? I like that artichoke stuff with the chips, you know? And of course, the old salsa with the chips, hallelujah. The Mexicans, I'm telling you, the greatest revelation they had was the day to put chips and salsa on the table. Hallelujah. And you got your choice. Cannot eat it, maybe I'll eat it, and it's all right. I mean, you know what I'm talking about, okay? Hallelujah. So it is an honor to be with you again this morning. I'm really honored that we can participate in the ordination of Daniel. Daniel, you, man, if anybody tries to put your fire out, shame on them, because the fire that's in you will jump out and get them before they even get any chance at all. So it's a real delight. Now, which one is your father? Stand up there, Papa. Come on, stand up there, all right? This man here is because of that man there. Hallelujah. Yeah. I don't know much about you, but I'm telling you, God says he's shining your trumpet more. He said he's been fine-tuning it. And there's a distinct sound in your latter days that will be greater than your former days. And God says, I'm warming up the trumpet. Not to take you out of here, but that through your voice, it will be the sound as a trumpet that will go forth. And the Lord says, I'm releasing that now because I need you in this hour for a generation that doesn't know me. In the name of Jesus. Lord, in the name of Jesus, I pray over him right now. I pray, Lord, for just a fresh release of the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of you, that the hope of his calling that's within him, that when he stands before you, he'll say, Lord, I have fought a good fight. And I have kept the faith. And I have finished the course. But Lord, he will hear those great words from you. Well done, thy good and faithful servant, in Jesus' name. Brother, I'm telling you, man, he's shining up your armor in the name of Jesus. No kidding. That's right, man. Hallelujah, man. Well, I tell you what, when you catch a big fish, the line goes out away from you first.
Yeah.
All right? But just keep reeling. And you kept reeling, and man, you got him back in the boat. Hallelujah. All right, man. Hallelujah. I'm going to pray that spirit of lying come off of him because he told me he'd take me fishing so far. That hasn't manifested. All right. Yeah, so. I'll work on your daughters. Maybe they'll give you a little help there, all right? So, hallelujah. He's the one that took the redfish home? Brother, you have created envy in this sister and I. I'm telling you. We were deeply disappointed in how you prayed. Because your cup runneth over. Well, it didn't run our way. Trust me, I'm telling you. We had to do without, but that's all right, church. God called her to the fast, and we all had to participate in it. Anyway, hallelujah. But, there's always hope for the future. Now, where's the lady that works with Daniel? I want you to stand up there, would you, sweetie? Okay? I'm going to embarrass you. I'd actually feel sorry for you that you have to work for him. Things, but I want to pray over you. I just felt when he says your name today, I just felt like God says that there's a discernment that's coming into you of situations that you're going to be facing in the days ahead with many. And I don't know if it's a catastrophe or a disaster or whatever it is, but the Lord says, I'm not going to use you to look for pity and sorrow. I'm going to look for you to the real deep needs of those that are coming. The word there he quoted this morning that we're to minister to the poor. The word the poor in the Greek there means temporarily unemployed. Okay, there's people that become temporarily unemployed. That's what the New Testament considered those people as poor people. And he said that there's a fresh anointing that will come upon you. And he said you're going to help those that are temporarily unemployed. Now here's what the Lord says. Do not be overwhelmed by their situation. And here's the clincher of it all. Their need is not your cause. Their need is your guidance for them. All right? Father, in the name of Jesus, I pray right now, Lord, Lord, your hand is upon these sisters right now in the name of Jesus. Lord, that there are those that are coming, Lord, and they don't know what to do. They don't know how they're going to feed their families. They don't know how they're going to pay their bills. They don't know that, Lord, and things. And Lord, you will bring them across their path, and they will speak a word that will be a creative word in the life of these people. And they don't want a handout. They simply want to know which direction to go. And let these two sisters be voices of direction. That is the greatest relief and economy that they can give to those that will be coming across their path. And let them have boldness to speak it forth and not worry about the results. Because once you speak it, you put it in their hands. Now it's up to them to act upon it. Lord, and I thank you for it now. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless y'all, all right? Is your insurance any cheaper than mine? He is now. Hallelujah. Okay. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. That's the right answer. I tell you. I'll see you right after the service. Okay. Hallelujah. What a great day. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I want to go a direction tonight or this morning. We've been talking about the need for discipleship again in the body of Christ. And we're seeing probably the largest church that we've ever seen in the history of mankind, but it's the most shallow. They have no depth to it, so they don't know what's transpired in their heart, they don't know how to make it manifest in their life. And so they continually get frustrated and upset, and they're wondering about God, and eventually the enemy takes that and begins to pull them out of the place where they should be. And so, We're gonna continue in a little bit in that direction this morning, but I got something that I feel like the Lord's put on my heart. I want you to go to Mark's Gospel with me. I'm glad to see all the Latinos here this morning. I may be an American, but I got Latino blood. Hallelujah. I remember my son is actually married to a Latino girl, and he looks like me. He's got dark hair and dark beard. And his grandmother on my wife's side had olive colored skin, and so he's kind of dark complected. So he kind of fits in. The only problem is he's 6'4". So he doesn't fit in too well, all right? So when we go to the big family outings, there's 10 of us and there's 2,000 of them. You know, so we don't say much because we know we're talking to a cousin somewhere, you know? And so they're always inviting us over to their parties and things like that. Well, you know, there's just so much chili you can eat. I mean, you know, what goes through the mouth comes out the... If it goes in hot, it comes out hot. All right, we'll put it that way, okay? All right, we'll leave that alone, okay? You know, but we always have a great time around them. And I remember a story that a friend of mine told me. He says, how many of you know that, how many like history? Anybody like history here? I like history. The story told when the Texas Rangers started that there was a criminal down on the border. I can't remember his name. We'll call him Jorge Rodriguez, you know. What, Hector? Probably Hector, all right? We'll call him Hector, okay? All right? And he robbed banks and trains and employees and everything. He robbed them on both sides of the border, Mexico and on this side. The Texas Rangers, you know, I mean, if you got one war, you know, thousands of people are doing war, how many Texas Rangers do you need? One. Okay, you'll get that later. The kids are looking at me like, what does that mean? You got to be from Texas to understand that. And so they put out a bounty on Hector. It said $10,000, and dead or alive. And so they captured him twice, but he escaped both times. And so finally, I can't remember the Texas Ranger's name. We'll call him Tex Smith or Tex. We'll call him Tex David, all right? And so he's down on the border, you know, and all of a sudden he's in his village, and he walks and he sees Hector. So he walks up behind him, puts a pistol to the back of his head, and he says, buddy, this is the end of the line. I'm going to kill you. I'm going to take you back. I'm going to get the reward, and I'm going to retire. And Hector says something to him in Spanish. And Tex goes, man, I don't know Spanish. I don't want to kill a man that he doesn't understand what I'm getting ready to do. He said, what am I going to do? You know, so by the time the little 10-year-old boy walked up and said, oh, senor, I'm bilingual. He said, oh, great. He said, you tell him, and he told him Tex had said. And so Hector says to him, he says, boy, tell him I haven't spent any of the gold, any of the silver, any of the money. It's 5 miles out of town. It's in a cave, and there's a big rock, and there's a mark on the rock, and this is the mark. And he told him what it was. He said, tell him that. If he'll only spare my life, he can have it all back. Little boy's going, he said, do you understand? And little boy goes, see, I understand. He says, okay, now tell him that. So he looked up at Tex Smith and he goes, Senor, Hector said he's had a good life and he's ready to die. He fixing to be one rich little Mexican boy. That's what it is. Now, boys, they're full of enterprise, I'm telling you, you know. I think so. Hallelujah. In Mark's gospel, oh boy. Well, it's raining now, so we can't go anyway, so. But in Mark's gospel, Jesus starts out, Mark's gospel is Matthew 5, 6, and 7 in one chapter. Actually, it's half a chapter, basically. And it's where Jesus is introducing the constitution to the kingdom of God. Now, one of the things that we said on our teaching yesterday was that Jesus did it, and then He did it, and they watched, and they did it, and he watched. Well, this is one of those times when Jesus did something, and they watched. So it says that Jesus doesn't say he got into a boat, all right? Many times when we think of Jesus being out on the water, you got to remember, Israel wasn't a great big fishing village. It wasn't a great ocean-type community or nation at all. There's very little of that that went on. Most of their water time was done with small boats and things like that on rivers and little ponds and things like this. But they're at the Sea of Galilee, so there wasn't very much expertise when it came to the Sea of Galilee. So Jesus is teaching, and the crowds kept getting more, bigger and bigger and bigger. And finally, what does he do? He gets into a ship. Now, it's interesting because this ship is not just a little sailboat, all right? It is actually a Roman troop carrier that would carry up to 100 to 150 troops because they had to move them fast. And so they used the water to move them between different places, all right? And so Jesus gets in the ship and he stands up on the bow of the ship, kind of like
Kind of like in Titanic, you know, when they're all, you know, that's the way I see Jesus, boys and girls, you know. Do you need, I hear Diana, what's her name? Selena singing in the background, you know, or Celine singing in the background while Jesus is teaching. Okay, you don't like my rendition. I just thought I'd throw a little light in there, all right? So here we are. He's now teaching out of this ship, and man, he's laying it out. I mean, he's throwing it out there. He's talking about his kingdom. He's talking about his laws. He's talking about his style. He's talking about his way of life. On and on he goes. And when he gets through, now this is where I want to start, all right? In verse 35, it says, chapter 4. I was just seeing if you're paying attention, all right? Okay. In chapter 4, in verse 35, it says, and the same day, now this is right after he's teaching, okay? When the evening was come, he said unto them, let us pass over unto the other side. And when they had sent away the multitude, they took him even as he was in the ship, and there were also other with him other little ships. That's a whole message on unity right there. And there arose a great storm of wind, and the waves beat into the ship, so that it was now full. And he was in the hinder part of the ship, asleep on a pillow. They awoke him and said unto him, Master, carest thou not that we perish? Don't you care about us? And he arose and rebuked the wind and said unto the sea, Peace be still. And the wind ceased, and there was a great calm. And he said unto them, Why are you so fearful? How is it that you have no faith? He didn't say a little faith. He said no faith. Okay, we'll move right along, all right? And they feared exceedingly. Why? Because what was going on in the sea, or because he said, you have no faith? How many of you know they would fix and go to the woodshed? How many of you know he'd get ready to lay some things out to them? I had just taught you this. I have just gone over this. I have just told you about the, you know, if you throw the seed out there and the sower and all this good stuff, and if you understood all this kind of stuff, but here Jesus now fixing to say, now listen, he said, I'm laying it on you because you have no faith in this situation, and I just got through teaching. Now let me ask you something. How many of you love Pastor? Okay, three of you. You need some help. Right? How many of you think you could love Pastor? Right? Let me throw that out here, all right? Okay. I know we think the pastors are part of the Antichrist system, but trust me, they're not. They're part of the Christ system. Okay? There is a difference. But how many of you were here last week and heard his message, or the last message you preached? All right? How many heard that last message you preached, okay? And how many can tell me what he preached on? Oh, now I see no hands, and everybody's dropping their head looking down in their Bible like this. You see, that's what Jesus was facing. He had just been preaching to them. He'd just been talking to them. And now all of a sudden he says, now you just can't hear what I've got to say. You've got to do what I've got to say. And so he says, I'm getting in this boat and we're going. And listen, when he says, let's go to the other side, it wasn't a suggestion. In fact, it was a rhema word from God. And the difference between the logos is you can read the logos and you can apply it to your life and you'll be benefited. But when God gives us a word from his mouth to our heart and speaks to us that way, that's what Daniel was talking about earlier, listening to the Holy Ghost, and he says those things, whether it's through an impression, whether it's through an audible voice, whether it is through a vision or a dream or whatever it is, God has a way of communicating with me. He may not communicate with me the same way he communicates with Pastor. He may not communicate with me the same way he communicates with Daniel. But he knows how to get your attention. And he would rather do it through his voice than through circumstances. Hello? Are you out there? How about this side over here? Boy, y'all look like you've been abandoned over here. But here Jesus is now, he's coming with those disciples. Now notice what happens. When we get a rhema word from God, all of a sudden we got to understand that God has spoken to us and he's ready to see what we're going to do with it. And guess what? He's not ready to speak the next thing until we do the last thing. Yes. Listen to me. God, don't ask God to bless your disobedience. There are consequences that go with disobedience. Right? Oh, but you know, I felt like the Lord told me to do this. Then do it. Whether you think it was actually God or not, go ahead and do it because it may have been God. Okay, moving right along, all right. Why? Because the rhema word coming from God is the spoken word. Romans chapter 10, it says what? That faith cometh by hearing, not Romans chapter 10. It says that, the one I want here is, faith cometh by hearing, hearing the word of God. Yeah, that's Romans 10. What's Romans 10? Anyway, Romans 10 is faith coming by hearing and hearing the word of God. And we think if that's the case, then we should have the most faith-filled church in the world anywhere on the planet. Why? Because the word, so much of the word has gone out. But the reality is, and the Amplified Bible says, faith cometh by hearing, and by hearing a word from God. You see? And so people come to me and say, well, I wrestle with my faith. And I said, have you got a word from God? If you don't have a word from God, there is no faith to go with it. Are you hearing me? You see, we have faith in what he's already done in the scripture and what the Bible says. But what this does is it validates when God speaks to us. And the problem that we don't want to wait upon and we don't want to wait for that word to come is because there is a price to pay to get a word from God. She went through that. Man, anytime you have somebody that loves coffee, because coffee is part of the manna of heaven, I'm telling you, you know, you got to have coffee. How many of you know God, coffee is God's will? And all the non-coffee drinkers, I'm sorry for you. You will have the revelation before you die. Hallelujah. But man, I know what it means. All of a sudden, the coffee tastes like it's metal. It tastes nasty. All of a sudden, God's saying, I'm trying to get your attention. So let's start with the coffee first. If that doesn't work, we'll go to the eggs. If that doesn't work, we'll get desperate and go to the bacon. Hallelujah. All right. You know. But the reality is God he's communicating with his nature. He's communicating with what he has created. And we are it's not how much we can impress God. It's how impacted we need to be by the voice of God that is coming into our life. Because it's only through the spoken word of God this day that can nations be transformed into the purposes and the destiny of God set in place. Notice, Jesus, he did what some of us were doing this morning. He went to sleep in the back of the ship. That was Joshua's ministry. He said, where was Joshua from? He says, he was from the land of Nod. Yeah. I had a lot of people like that in my church. I couldn't stand it when people go to sleep on me. I mean, I had one guy, he was a city planner. And man, he had a physical condition, I knew it. But every time, as soon as I start preaching, man, he'd go sound asleep. He's down, you know. So I go back there. You know, I wouldn't wake him up. I'd just go stand beside him. And his wife is looking at me like, oh my God, what are you going to do? And then I'd make a point and I'd slap my hands and he'd wake up, man. You know, hallelujah. I'm thinking, man, that's what needs to happen in the church. God just needs to smack his hand to wake us up. Okay, moving along here. All right, so man, I mean, as soon as that we get in the service, man, how many wives have ever had an elbow ministry? Ever had an elbow ministry? You know what an elbow ministry is? My God, he's coming. He's coming down the aisle. You know, hurry up, you know. Like so, you know. So we had to pray for a lot of elbows in those days. Hallelujah. You know, but the reality is that he was tired. If you've ever done ministry, you understand that people think, oh, you just get up here and say some words. I'm telling you, I'm fighting hell. I'm fighting demons right now. I'm calling on angels to come forth. I'm calling on the Spirit of God to move. Because in a service, man, I'm telling you, darkness is wanting to come in. And we are fending it off with the light that's being released out of our life. Every one of us are participating in routing the enemy in this service. That's why we were talking about this the other day. You know, my worship team, there's worship teams now that get up and they'll play their music and they'll do their set and then they go sit out and drink coffee and have donuts and talk to one another. I said, listen, man, that'll never happen to me. If you're going to war with me, you're going to fight the whole battle. And if you get wounded, shame on you. We'll nurse you back to hell. But I'm telling you, you're going to fight to the end with me. That's a good centurion. Hallelujah. Okay, let me run along. He goes, it's evening time. He's wiped out. They asked Jack Hayford. He had a large church in California. He said to him, Brother Hayford, he says, man, you bring such deep revelation and insight, all that kind of stuff. He said, what do you do after the service? He said, I go home, change my clothes. He said, I turn on the television, and I watch the most vilest thing I can turn on. He said, why do you do that? And he says, I got to get back to normal. Okay, you didn't ever preach, you don't understand what I just said, all right? Hallelujah. Because notice here, all of a sudden now, he's in the evening watch. Why is this so significant? Because in the evening watch is when your spirit is the most attentive to what's going on in the spirit realm. I would much rather have a Sunday night service than I would a Sunday morning service. Sunday morning, we're all kind of, all right, you know, let's see what happens. Tickled today. Let's see what we can do today. I've done my religious duty for the week, and you know, I got everything taken care of, you know. And so what they do, they bring their demons and they leave with their demons. Some of you are going, listen, leave my demons alone. Yeah. I told my wife the other day, we got into a struggle, and I said, listen, I'm going to cast that out of you. She said, leave him alone. So she's not here today, so I can talk about it. Hallelujah. Notice here. Notice he was in the ship. He was in the ship, and all of a sudden now, as he was in the ship, notice that when he gives a revelatory word, here's what you've got to understand. He watches over that word to perform. Now here's the great thing about it. He works it in you before he'll let you release it out of you. David Buckingham used to say, the truth, how many want the truth? Yeah. There's six of you, all right, it's getting better. We're growing in this service, hallelujah. How many of you want the truth? Yeah. Why, because the truth will set you free. But David Buckingham always told us, he says, Terry, the truth will make you miserable before it sets you free. Why, because the scripture says that the word of God is tried seven times before it's released. So many people come and say, the Lord showed me, and I'm going, oh my gosh. I cringe. Why? Because they gotta live it, they gotta get it in them, and then it's gotta come out of them. And long before it comes out of them, then they gotta go through holy heaven. You know, which looks like hell, you know, in their life. And I don't know about you, but how many of you know the first song you learned in your ministry or your life and when you come to Jesus is Amazing Grace? How many like the song Amazing Grace? Isn't that the greatest song? That's the first song that we learned, and man, it just downloads on us. You know what the second song is? I never promised you a rose garden. Hallelujah. Yeah. God throws a little gospel, a little country in there at the same time. Yeah. Look at this. All right. Jesus was in the boat. He was in the boat. He's watching over his word to perform it. Why? Because he wants to find out what Jesus, we need to find. He wants us to understand what he is doing today. I'm not impressed with your preaching about a history God. I want to know, I know what God did in history, and I'm thankful for history. But because of history, we are here where we are today because God is releasing, according to the book of Peter, he's releasing present truth that will undo the works of the devil for this hour. The problem has been in our pulpits, in our leadership, in our conferences, in our seminars, is we have preached about a God of yesterday, and the people don't know who God is today. Okay. We come and we try to have church. We try to put the new into the old wineskins. We're going in there whether you like it or not. And what I don't understand, I ignore. Isn't that right? And if somebody asks me about it, I go, well, that doesn't sound like God to me. Of course, I have no idea whether it's God or not, but it doesn't sound like God to me. The old wineskins keep coming up. The old wineskins are the ones who are putting people in bondage.
It's the old wineskins that keep people in their bondages. It's not the new wineskin. Why? Because you have to work the new wineskin. The old wineskin, all you have to do is keep pouring more wine in it. And so say, my church is not growing. I said, listen, why not? Are you working the wineskin or are you just rubbing the old wineskin? My business is not growing. Why? Because you're more comfortable with the old wineskin? Listen, I'm telling you, the Japanese have already made it cheaper and better, so you might as well get rid of your old wineskin. Look at your neighbor and say, I think I'm going to be Japanese for a while. Church in the nations is not working. Why? Because we're not doing it God's way. We're having services about God without God. And most of our services, you see, we think if we have an emotional experience while we're sitting in church, God showed up. Sometimes that's just simply my flesh. What if God showed up one Sunday and everything had to be quiet? Pentecostals would die. Baptists would be looking for the book. And the Methodist goes, who's God? We got to step over into the new wineskin. Brother, let me say this, Daniel, and I just want to bless you with this. God's been stripping you to release you. It's easy to follow form even without faith. And so just like Joseph, God had to strip him down from his from the world first. Then he had to strip him down from his flesh. And then he had to strip him down from himself. And then he was a candidate to be used by God. And you've gone through those. I want you to know where your journey's been. It's been a good stripping. Why? And the way you'll know that stripping has done its complete work, there will be a sensitivity that will be upon you for his bride as much as it was for your daughters this morning. Yeah. And this guy's full of ministry. I started to say full of stuff, but I'm going to change that full of ministry. Okay, now look at here. Whenever Jesus is in your boat, he's going to raise up a storm around you to show you what is within you.
Yes.
And what do? We fight the storms. Oh, pray for me, Pastor. You all right, Pastor? Pray for me. Oh, pray for me. Why? Oh, I'm going through this horrible place in my life. Oh, thank you. Okay, let me pray. God, continue. Make it deeper. Make it higher. Make it more miserable in her life. Make it more, oh God, just bless her with misery this week. Hallelujah. God, and oh Lord, just let her pants be full of holes and everything else. Let her car break down 3 or 4 times. And God, just more and more of that. Brother, you'd be stoned in a moment. Where's the conferences that says, come to our conference, we'll show you how to endure misery. We don't have those. Those storms rise up in us. Why? Because Satan's accusation's goal is to stop the word of God that you just received. The ground teaching and all that stuff is very pertinent right in here. Why? Because the attacks come when you begin to act upon what God says. Why? It's because he wants to take the word that is in you and bind it up. Bind it up. Ye, help us, Lord. The Bible says in 1 Corinthians 16 and 9, there are at the door of opportunity, everybody say door of opportunity.
Door of opportunity.
There are many adversaries. Oh man, I hear this new level teaching. Oh, we're going to a new level. You really? What's that look like? How do you get there? The door to any new level in Christ. You don't hear me. See, why? Because we feel like
through a crisis or through a disaster or through a storm. Somewhere God's mad at us and we have failed him. And God's saying, that ain't it at all. I told you I'd never leave you or forsake you. But I am with you sometimes. No, no. For me, it's sometimes, because sometimes I don't think he's with me. But how many of you know he's with me always and in all ways, all right? Very important to understand that. So Paul said it this way. I love this one. You know, it says, there's fightings without and fears within. 2 Corinthians chapter 7 and verse 5. Hallelujah. How many of you know that while we're doing battle out here, everything inside of us is saying, you can't win this. And we have to keep pumping ourselves up. Oh, you got the victory. You got the victory. Yeah, I got the victory. But inside I'm going, oh, I'm dying. That's exactly what happened to them, to the disciples. Man, they're on the ship. Jesus is in the boat with them. He said, gave them a word to go to the other side. You're going to get to the other side. And so, man, they're out there going, praise God, we're going to the other side. Glory to God, man. Maybe they got out there. The word in the Matthew was seismos, and it means there was an earthquake under the water. And on that particular sea, it created unusual waves, tsunami-type waves. And man, it started filling the boat. How many of you know all of a sudden they're fighting the water? You know, bailing it out. They're fighting the situation that's going on. But inside, this fear is just rising up. And Jesus said, your fear is greater than the faith that I released. Now let me say this. Faith does not ignore facts. But facts will never be greater than faith. Moving on. There's a law in the kingdom. There's a law, and it's called the law of warfare and the law of wrestling. When do you do warfare? When do you do wrestling? Warfare comes from without, but wrestling comes from within. When Paul talked about wrestling against principalities and powers and rulers of darkness, it wasn't that they were controlling our life, they were influencing our life. And it's easier to give in to the principalities and powers and rulers of darkness, spiritual wickedness. It's easy to do that than to wrestle with the reality that I am somebody else that is not part of that. And we wrestle with that. If you don't wrestle, and I need to pray for you because there's something different about going on with you. Storms come, they reveal our attitude. Look at your neighbor and say, I got an attitude. Notice what they said. Say it again, I got an attitude. Now listen, your attitude depends on your altitude. We got any pilots here? If there's a pilot here, he'd know that one of the instruments on his dashboard is an instrument called your attitude. It measures the attitude of that plane. And you better know how to read that attitude, because if not, you're kissing the ground and we're kissing you goodbye. We have the same thing in us. It's called the Holy Spirit. It's called our focus. It's called our mindset. That's our attitude. And then the higher it goes, the altitude that we have with our attitude, the more we will know that God will do certain things in our life. It's very important we understand that. Notice what happens now. Jesus shows us how to face, well, let me back up, on attitude. Notice what their attitude was. Here it was. Don't you care? How many have ever said that before? Well, I just don't think God's hearing me. That's the same thing. I just don't know, you know, God's hearing my prayer or not. I'm just kind of like, I just don't know. I'm kind of getting sick of this. You know? Kind of like the old couple laying in bed in their early 80s. Turn out the light, and she leaned over and says, honey, we've been tried, tested, and true. He leaned back over here and said, honey, I'm sick and tired of you too. We got to check that attitude. How many of you know what I'm talking about? Anybody who's been married longer than 2 years understands exactly that phrase, all right? Jesus shows us how to face a storm. A lot of times, and this is what happens with people, they go up to the storm and they turn around and run away from it. Or others, they'll try to go around it. They'll try to figure it out. They'll manipulate and they'll hear from themselves about and say God told them, and they kind of slip around it. But how many of you know, sooner or later, you try to slip around it, you get down the trail, guess what? That thing is down there waiting for you, and it's bigger. I'm telling you, just bust the thing. Just go right at it and say, listen, man, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. I'm more than a conqueror because Christ lives in me. He loves me. He cares for me. He promised he would never leave me or forsake me. I'm telling you what, I'm going through this because on the other side is the victory and on the other side is the reward. Think about it. Jesus, it says in Hebrews that he, for the joy that was set before him, I'm telling you, he endured the cross. The cross was no joy. I want to tell you that. I don't know if anybody popped up and said to the Roman soldiers, hey guys, listen, I'm ready to be crucified today. I'm all happy about it. No. Jesus wasn't looking at the crucifixion. He was looking at the other side where he was going to be seated at the right hand of the Father. And when you realize you're going through something, all it does is it shores up. You're seated with him in heavenly places. All right, I got to get finished. Y'all quit interrupting me. Facing the situation, you've got to go through it. I had a friend of mine was pastoring a large church up on Long Island, New York. He told me a story one time. He said, we had gotten an electric bill, and the electric bill, he said, I didn't have the money to pay for it. And we got the final notice. How many have ever heard of the final notice? I mean, you know, that's the time when everything draws up inside of you. He said, we got the final notice. And I said, well, how much was the bill? And he said, the bill was $10,000. And he said, I didn't know what I was going to do. He said, so I was praying that we'd have a great service, and I was going to present it to the church, and we'd pay that bill on Monday. He said, Friday night, it started snowing. The worst snow that ever had. The island shut down, couldn't drive over the highways. Nobody came to church. And he goes, oh my God, what are we going to do? I said, well, first of all, David, you depended on the church and not God. And he goes, I know, let me finish the story. I said, okay. He said, I'm praying, God, you see this bill. He said, I laid it out there right in front of God. I said, God, you see this bill? You got to meet the need. I'm giving the church back to you. I said, great for you. What happens? On Monday, the old lady came up. She was from a Jewish background. She walked up. She goes, oh, Pastor, I've been gone down to Florida for a certain period of time. And he said, I've been negligent on sending my tithe. And so I wanted to write you a check this morning. And here's a check. And the check was for $10,000. I mean, you know, God's always late. Yes, he is. I need him to show up yesterday. He didn't show up till tomorrow. Now, he never late, but my concept of God's time is totally different. It's like he got the wrong watch at Christmas. I don't know. Notice what happened. Jesus stands up, and he begins to speak to the storm. He rebukes the storm. You see, when you're going through the problem, quit talking about it. Quit entertaining it. Yeah, if somebody wants to know, you lay the facts out. Yeah, this is the situation. But let me tell you what. I'm speaking to the storm. And notice what he said. Oh, I love it. Shut up. I love it. That's Texas vernacular there, brother. You know, shut up. That's what he was saying. Hush, be still. Be quiet. And what was that for the benefit of the storm, or was that for the benefit of those he was discipling? All of a sudden the waves calm down. You know, and the peace comes. You know, and listen, that's what happens when you start speaking to the storm, because then the governor gets back in place and he begins to guide you. He's called the peace of God that passes all understanding. Don't guard the peace that God puts in your heart with everything that you have. Now look at this, and I finish. You know what that means, don't you? Nothing. He says to them, they feared exceedingly and said to one another, what manner of man is this that even the wind and the sea obey him? Well, first he said to them, why are you so fearful? That puts an emphasis in the Greek language, that puts an emphasis that this thing has really mastered them. This thing is controlling them so much that it totally removed faith out of their life. And notice the very word that he'd given them in verse 35, 36, right through there, that was the faith word that was released, and they were so paralyzed by it that it took the word right out of their life. So I know people come in and say, I got a word from God, and I said, yeah, but is it mixed with faith? Because a lot of times, the so fearful will actually bind up the revelatory word that you got, and it cannot come to pass. Let me say this to you. In 1 Corinthians chapter 13 is the chapter. Isn't that right? We all like a love chapter, don't we? But in there it says, talking about love, and then it says, and prophecy will fail. And then he goes on and describes more about love. When you look up that phrase, and prophecy will fail, the word fail there means to complete its assignment. Prophecy, it means when God talks, when God moves, he doesn't move in a straight line like this. God is always moving in circles. Always like this. But see, with God, there's no beginning and there's no end. So God thinks this way. So when prophecy comes, it's setting things in motion. It's happening. But when all of a sudden we get there, and listen, we, because of our lack of faith or our no faith or our fear that is dominant in our life, guess what? That prophecy cycle is completed, and we try to grab a hold of it after we see somebody else do it. Oh, look at that. I love it. Do you love that little girl? Oh, man, is that a granddaughter? Oh, man, bless you, Grandma. We can just sit and talk about grandchildren forever, you know, but anyway. There are some prophecies that you're hanging on to that's already completed. It's a cycle. You might as well get over it, and you might as well admit it. I missed it. God says, now I think I can work with you. You've gotten honest with yourself. But we're trying to hang on to prophecies that were not working. You're not working. Chances are it's coming to an end. God says, I got to move on down the road. Why? Because God's always forward moving. See, most of our prophecies we get, they become wishes, not faith. Oh, I wish God would do what he said he was going to do. I wish God, I hope God will do what he's going to do. I know God told give me a word. And I hope it comes to pass. I said, listen, it ain't going to come to pass. Not with that attitude. Jesus, he comes, and any storm that comes against those that are working their faith, those that are handling their faith, and a storm rises up, and you're passing through it, there will come a time when Jesus says, that's enough, shut up, hush, be still. I got to get peace back in the midst of this situation. Jesus spoke to the storm. Oh, Lord. Why is this so important? I'm going to give you a little history here. Why did Jesus use this situation to speak to the disciples this way? And not only the disciples, but all the other 150 Roman soldiers that were on that ship. Why? Now, don't be shocked when I say this, but Jesus had more of a Roman mentality than he did a Jewish man. Why? Because he was raised in Galilee. And Galilee had less than 5% Jewish. The rest were pagan religions, Roman religions. He also traveled all over the empire. And he was more friends with the Romans than he was with the Jews. That's one of the reasons they hated him, because he was
He was friendly with their enemy, their announced enemy. Jesus comes along, and now he's now saying something, and he uses this situation. Why? Because Tacitus tells us a story that one time Julius Caesar had assembled his troops together, and they were going across from Apollonia to Briticus, not British, but Briticus is the name of another region. They were going by ship over there, and one of these great storms rose up. And all the soldiers, you know, it wasn't just that one ship, all the ships that were accompanying that military regime, they were crossing. All of a sudden now, fear began to dominate all of them. And Caesar comes from the back of the boat, and he goes up to the captain. He says, steady the ship. He says, steady the ship. We're going to make it across here. And he says to that captain, and the captain got courage by what Julius Caesar was saying to him. And then he stands on the bow and he says to the soldiers, do not fear. He said, I'm going to speak. He says, he spoke to the storm and the storm subsided. Now from that point on, all the soldiers, you know, it went all, they were the CNN, they were the social media of those days. And the story started, and we don't know for sure that is an accurate account of it, but history records that was one of the things that happened, and they began to treat Julius Caesar as a god, a demigod. So now these Roman soldiers knowing that story, these disciples knowing that story, all of a sudden, are you really God? Can I really say that you're Jehovah God? You are the one true God? You're the Almighty God? Well, if that's the case then, let's see what you're going to do here. And Jesus, knowing that they had all that mindset from that historical story that they all understood because it was taught in all their universities, taught in their schools and everything, he stands up and said, listen, that guy was a pretender. The real thing is standing right here. And I don't care what you're going through right now, but all those things out there that have been coming against you, they are nothing but pretenders. And you may have heard things like it before, but I'm telling you, there is one. His name is called Jesus. He's the King of Kings. He's the Lord of Lords. He is mighty, and he is able to bring the calmness to your storm no matter what you're faced with. It stunned them. Stunned them. Jesus says, what happens? They get to the other side. They get to the other side. Now, part of the reasons why I think the disciples were a little bit hesitant, he said, guys, we're going over to Gadarene. And they're all going, Gadarene? That is a Roman prison. That's a Roman prison. And Gadarene came from the tribe of Gad, the half-tribe of Gad that stayed on the other side of the river when Moses came out. So what happens is now, here that it had become a Roman province, and that's where they had the prisoners. And so in there was two demoniac guys. And they knew that. That guy just didn't show up one day and say, hey, I got demons, so I'll let y'all know. Didn't happen that way. All of a sudden now, they get to the other side, and who greets them? Here comes this demoniac guy. And Jesus, you know the story. Jesus asked him his name. My name's Legion. And even his demons had demons. That's pretty bad. And when Jesus, you know, he goes down, first time in history we ever had devil ham, you know, right there. And he took care of it all. Disciples and the Roman soldiers, they learned something that day. God was with them. I want you to bow your heads, would you please? God's exposing things today in this hour that we're living in. He's exposing our fears. He's exposing our inability to trust the power of God to fulfill what he says. He's undoing the attempts of Satan to bind the word that God gives to us. What God wants us to know is that the word, when he gives us a word, it has a greater purpose than we presently realize.
Who is this? Who then is this? They ask in verse 41. It's Jesus. It's Jesus. Some of you are in a storm today. You're in a storm. Your mind is racing and being consumed of imaginable loss. There's rehearsals going on in your mind, and it builds fear into your life that I'm going to lose this, or this is going to be taken from me, or this is going to happen. Many of you have many questions. This is part of the fight that's going on. Many of you have questions, and you don't have any answers right now. God isn't saying much to you. And so you just keep trudging on in life, but I'm telling you, you get weary from that. You get beat down. Suspicions have arisen in you in place of your ability to trust and to hand faith. Suspicions of, what does all this mean? And we begin to question, and here's the big one, don't you care? What has this produced? It's caused us a loss of our concern for others, and it has dulled our sensitivity. We need a word to silence the storm and to release the peace of God. I want you to do something. This is what the Lord instructed me. I want you, and listen to my instructions first before you act. The Lord said, tell them to take an object. Doesn't care what, in the Bible they used handkerchiefs. God said, take an object. And then we're going to line up across here, and I'm going to put anointing oil on that object. And the Lord says to put that object in the midst of whatever storm that you're facing and see my hand begin to work. It's not a superstitious thing. It's a prophetic thing. Remember when Moses raised the snake on the pole, and there's other things that happened through the scripture. But God says, I want you to anoint an object that they bring to you. It may be something very special to you. It may just be simple, just a hanky. It may be something simple. But your job is to let God anoint it. And then your responsibility is to put it in a place that it can do its work. It may be a lost one. Maybe a sick person. It may be someone who needs deliverance. Somebody needs a job. It may be a financial thing. Whatever it is, God's quickening that to you right now. So I want you to dig in your purse or your pocket or borrow something from somebody or what. Now, don't go borrowing $100, you know, whatever. But we're going to anoint it, all right? We're going to anoint it. And then I want you, your job this week is to take it as a disciple. Move beyond your fear and your lack of faith. Move beyond that and let faith take over and simply just put it in a place. All right, everybody, stand up with me.